Namaste and welcome to the third session of the storytelling series conducted by the regional level guides of Western region. Today our story is on Durga Puja and Navratri. And as we all know, Durga Puja, Navratri, Dashara is one of the most popular festivals of India. In fact, this is celebrated almost all across India, right from the north to south, west to east, in various forms. And this is also synonymous with elaborate celebrations that include stage decorations, pandals, visit to pandals with family in West Bengal and Northeast, recital of the legend, enacting the story and chanting the scriptures, public celebrations of classical and folk dances like Garba in Gujarat, and so on. In fact, this is one festival which is almost kind of celebrated pan-India, as I informed earlier. As this year, we are kind of forced to stay back home and mostly observe this in a little scaled down manner, just for considering the well-being of ourselves and our fellow beings. But that should not dampen our spirit. That's why we have with us today Mandirita Sengupta, who will be taking us to the story behind the rich tradition and bring this festival live. In fact, I would like to thank Mandirita for agreeing to our request and to do the storytelling on Durga Puja and Navratri. Let me give a brief about our storyteller today. Mandirita, popularly known as Mondi, is a Ministry of Tourism recognized regional level tour guide based out of Mumbai, and she is also a spiritual practitioner and healer and an international qualified trainer, a psychological counselor and psychotherapist, an ex-GM of Reliance Industry Limited, currently a consultant with the Reliance Industry. She is also the faculty in the aviation industry for cabin crews and training wing of the American consulate, and a corporate trainer as a professional. She is also a speaker healer in the International Yoga Festival. She has a world record. She is a world record holder and also mountaineer. She was in fact felicitated by late Prime Minister Srimati Indira Gandhi. She is a national swimmer, a national award winner, author and photographer. While she has performed Indian classical dance and music nationally and globally, such as the multifaceted talent of our speaker today. As a philanthropic social worker, her mission has been to serve and support orphans, underprivileged children, old age, supportless people, spiritually elevating the masses and transforming scars into stars through healing, counseling and training. She conducts tours all over India and runs a yoga and meditation center in the Himalayas, in fact in the foothills in Dehradun, and conducts spiritual retreats for the domestic and international seekers. With this, now I invite Ms. Mandirita Sengupta to take over the web space and take us through this amazing story of Durga Puja and Navratri for the next couple of 1 hour. Thank you, Mandirita, for accepting our invitation, and welcome all. I also invite all our participants today who have taken time to join us. It's a Monday, but still, we are really grateful to you to come join this webinar series. Over to you, Mandirita. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Namaste. Good afternoon, everybody. Before I show the screen, I would like to see the beautiful faces of everybody. I don't want to feel I'm talking to blank screens. So for a minute, if you could just put on your videos so that I can have a just, you know. And then when I share the screen, you can all switch off your videos if you wish. So welcome to this session. As a part of the Ministry of Tourism and Culture, I am privileged to, you know, have this opportunity to share my knowledge about Durga Puja and Navratri. We all know the general, story of Durga Puja or Navratri, most of us, because we've grown up in that culture. But I'm going to take it in a different direction where, I want to talk about the spiritual aspect of it, the spiritual essence of it, which you will be able to correlate with your own life. Because the Sanatan Dharma has been so rich. Whatever it has given to us, it is not just stories. It is about our life, our practices, and our lifestyle. So I don't want to waste time. Let us directly go into the screen share and I'll start the session. Thank you very much. Okay. Okay, so this is the event, the festival, about the festival of mythology, significance of the spiritual significance, the esoteric meaning of Durga Puja and Navratri, the significance of the rituals, the Navratri festival, the spiritual significance of Navratri, the relation between the festival and our day-to-day life. That is what I'm going to talk about. So, then we have, these are the pandals, if you see. Beautiful pandals. In fact, 1 year, see, they had made the London Bridge. This is again the Akshardham Temple. Then there was the stupa of Madhya Pradesh.
The desire without batting an eyelid, the arrogant Mahishasur said, Lord, I don't want any man or god to be able to kill me. Brahma raised his hand in blessing and said, Tathastu, so be it, my child. A twinkle in Brahma's eyes gave away the fact that maybe Mahishasur had left a loophole while seeking his blessing. Time would tell. Armed with this boon, Mahishasur considered himself immortal, as no man or god could lay hands on him. In his rage and pride, he practically destroyed the earth. The land was soon covered in darkness, and his massacres were widespread. Not only that, he chased away the gods out of heaven. Scared, the gods went running to Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva and narrated their misfortune. The lords Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva were hopping mad. They conferred for a moment, and then they held each other and started to radiate a blinding light, a light never seen before. Out of this beautiful light was born the ten-armed goddess Durga, the embodiment of Adi Shakti. One by one, the gods approached her and gifted her a dazzling array of weapons. The mighty Sudarshan Chakra was given to her by Lord Vishnu. She got a Kamandal, or pitcher, from Lord Brahma. She got a quiver full of arrows from Lord Varuna, the god of the sea. Lord Yama, the god. Of death, giver. A powerful Savata, Indra's white elephant, gave Goddess Durga a bell. Its noise helped her confuse the demons. Lord Shiva gave her a dangerous trident. The mighty Himalayas gave Goddess Durga a lion to ride upon. Armed with 10 weapons, gifted to her by the gods, one for each arm, she looked ready to show Mahishasur who the boss was and went into battle with him. At last, the balance of life was restored. To celebrate this victory, we perform Durga Puja every year. Durga Puja is a 10-day carnival in Bengal. This day is also called the Dussehra. And we celebrate Lord Ram killing Ravan too.
Okay, so that is the mythology of Durga. Now let me just tell you of where did in our Sanatan Dharma, we have seen so many gods and goddesses. Where have they come from? Initially, there was only Parabrahman or the Supreme Being. And what is God? God is pure light with energy and consciousness. So when that pure light, it radiates into different rays, they come out in the form of different gods. That is why we have different gods performing different roles. If you see, Ganesha is for removing obstacles. Shiva is the recreation god who destroys evil and recreates. Lakshmi is for example, prosperity and abundance. So in this way, every aspect of God is named as a deity. And Durga is the deity of Adi Shakti. So she is basically power, the power required to destroy evil. That is basically the role of Durga. So this, as you see, is basically Mandrita. So I was born as a baby. Then I grew up and I started going to school. I became a student. So my teachers used to call me student. Then I'm a trainer, a guide, and a counselor. So people calls me, you know, teacher, trainer, guide, whatever. Then I got married and my husband started calling me beau, which is wife. I played different roles of housekeeping and taking care of household. Then when I gave birth to a baby, to two babies, two lovely babies, my children started calling me mama. So I became the mother of children. And in the future, I will one day become probably a grand, you know, I'll have a, my son will get married, my daughter will get married, I will become a mother-in-law. So then my daughter-in-law and son-in-law will call me mother-in-law. I'll become a grandmother. And when I become a grandmother, my grandchildren will call me grandmother. If you notice, I, Mandrita or Mondi, is the same identity playing different roles, being called by different names. So if you see that these names, all the names, all the roles that I'm playing, same happens with God. So God Parabrahman, he's playing different roles in different names, but the identity is the same. Why I'm telling you these is you will get to know when I correlate everything at the end. So, these three deities have created Durga. That is Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva or Mahesh. Now, I'll tell you a story. Think about yourself that you want to start a new business. When you want to start a new business, first you will decide whether you want to start a manufacturing business or maybe a reproduction or maybe resale. Whatever it is, you collect information, you gather knowledge, you accumulate your capital, and then you invest in that particular business. So the knowledge that you get is from the internet, from books, different areas. Once you start your business, you then employ people in your company. When you employ people in your company, they start working for you. You start taking care of your company. You start taking, lot of care, love, protection. You give protection. You are a provider then. You are providing to your employees. Now, suppose one employee becomes corrupt and he starts spreading evil. Then what do you do? You would want to retrench him or eliminate him so that he does not spread that poison in the whole company. That is why what happens is, what you do is you then use your power to retrench them. Similarly, in God's company, Brahma is the creator God who has created this whole universe and Mother Earth. Now, when he needed knowledge, he got it from his counterpart, Saraswati, who is the goddess of knowledge. When creation was created, when Mother Earth was created, he handed it over to Vishnu. Then the role of Vishnu comes over, who is the protector and provider and preserver. Now, when he is running the company, even he needs a lot of wealth, wealth of love, wealth of money, wealth of everything. So that is provided by him, by his counterpart, the goddess of wealth, Lakshmi. Then as this expands, humanity expands, and there are extremists, terrorists come into existence, then he hands over them to Shiva or Mahesh. He is not the destroyer God, but he is the reconstructor God. He destroys evil to recreate. He's a recreation God. So when we have a war, we need Shakti or power. So comes the role of Durga, who provides the power of war, destruction of evil. And then finally, evil is destroyed. So why I told you about all these three is all, if you notice that every God has a counterpart complementary to each other. They cannot work without each other because they're providing each other with different kinds of aspects, different aspects of God. Right? So, sorry. So, why is, So, as per the Chinese concept of yang and yin, it is basically the female aspect and the male aspect. So if you see the Ardha Narishwar, it's the same. It is basically the Shakti and also the masculine aspect of God, which works together. And then finally, the best result or the outcome is produced. So if you see even our brains, it has a male aspect, a female aspect. Everything balances when both these yin and yang aspects of each other works in combination too. That is why you will see, notice that even procreation happens when there is a union of the male and the female. Similarly, in the universe, there is Father Sky and Mother Earth. Mother Earth is the feminine aspect, whereas Father Sky is the masculine aspect. So when they work together, harmony, balance, everything works properly. So if you notice now, I said Brahma is creation. The creation God, Brahma plus versus Saraswati, together they are called divine light. Light means knowledge, wisdom, and creative energy. That is the creative aspect of God. Then comes Vishnu and Lakshmi. Vishnu and Lakshmi, they are the divine love aspect, which is actually the providence aspect of God. They are providers. They are the aspect of God. Similarly, at the end comes Shiva and Parvati. They are called divine power. This divine power means the power to fulfill, the willpower to fulfill or manifest what you want to achieve, what you want to do. So these three aspects of divine light, divine love, and divine power, which is Brahma, Vishnu, and Mahesh, is there in every religion. Spirituality is universal knowledge spoken in the language of different religions. Every religion has this spiritual truth. And Parvati or Durga plays the most important role because she is the one who finally destroys the evil. So I'll show you the similarity in religions also. So my guide friends, when you go to Elephanta, you have seen we do have the omniscient, all-knowing God, Brahma, the omniprovident, all-giving God, which is Vishnu, and the omnipotent, which is Shiva. So divine light, divine love, and divine power. In Christianity, this Trinity aspect also exists. So if you think about yourself, each of us, we have these three aspects in us. We have Brahma in us, we have Vishnu in us, we have Shiva in us. We have wisdom, knowledge, the creation aspect. We can create. We think of, new things, new ideas. We think of creating business. We think of creating new projects. Whatever we are creating, that creation is basically the Brahma working within us. Then when we are loving our children, we are loving our work, we are loving our home, we are providing, we are working for everybody at home to give with responsibility, with reliability, we are playing the role of Vishnu. So the divine love in us is acting. Similarly, when we are destroying evil within us, for example, if you're intolerant, your child is very, very naughty. What is the child's action trying to teach you? The child is actually unconsciously the divine child of God, which is you've given birth to this child, is trying to teach you patience, is trying to teach you tolerance. So if you notice I, which is you, you have all the three aspects of God within you. And the same thing is there in every religion. So this is the Trinity aspect in Christianity. They say Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Father is divine power, which is the Shiva aspect. The Son is divine love, which is the Vishnu aspect. And the Holy Spirit is the divine light or the wisdom aspect or the Brahma aspect. I will correlate all these with Durga at the end. So in Islam also, we have Al-Muqtadir, which means divine power, or it is same as Shiva and Parvati, the dual combination of Shiva and Parvati. Then Al-Wadud is the divine love aspect of God, which is again Vishnu, and Lakshmi. Then we have Al-Khalid with divine light, which is the aspect of Brahma and Saraswati. Similarly, in Egyptian tradition also, we have Osiris, Isis, and Horus. So Osiris is the power or Shiva and Parvati aspect of God. Isis is the love aspect of God, which is Vishnu and Lakshmi. And Brahma and Saraswati comes in Horus. And you know that the evil eye is actually the symbol of Durga in our tradition. Our Durga is the one who kills evil and is what is there also in Egyptian tradition. It is also there in Judaism. There is God, the Father, God, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Trinity aspect is almost and always there in all the religions. So understand that the Shakti, the power, which actually destroys evil, is final or Parvati. So, who is Durga, basically? If I ask you, who is Shakti? What is the Shakti within you? Who is the Asura? The Asura within us. If you see, what is Durga doing? Durga is killing the evil within us. All the malice that we have within us, the negative thoughts, the negative words, the negative action that we do. When we neutralize this, when we eliminate these, when we kill this within us, the Durga aspect within us is active then, playing the role. Similarly, The Durga within us also kills the selfishness, hatred, prejudice, envy, jealousy, anger, anxiety, the dishonesty, insecurity, despair, hopelessness. So these are our real asuras. All the greens, all in us. All the enemies are within us. We don't have to look for enemies outside. We already have asura within us. We already have Durga within us. And that Durga has to be activated to kill, destroy the asura within us. So this is the festival of inner purification. Physically, we are seeing as the idol of Durga, we are seeing the idol of Asura, we are seeing all the 10 arms, we are seeing the weapons. But basically, if you go internally inside, then it is nothing but the festival of your emotional toxins, removing your mental toxins, removing your physical toxins in your own home, in your comfort zone. Why your own home? Because in your mind, you are comfortable. You are in your comfort zone. That is your home. So within your home, you can activate the Durga within you and you can kill all the asuras that erupt. So the inner festival of inner purification, you must use the invisible 10 hands and the divine weapons that God has given us. I will talk about it. There is so much I can talk for hours and hours telling you each and every significance, but very concisely, I'm trying to finish it as early as possible with the maximum knowledge. So we know that Durga has with 10 weapons. What is the significance of them? Before I go into the significance, we know that all these deities have actually given these weapons to Durga. So each weapon actually we have within us. They are all, symbolic, basically. So the trident is there, the sword is there. Then we have the chakra, we have the conch, we have the sphere. I'm not going to go in depth, but I will talk about how we can use these inner weapons. So as per Patanjali Yoga Sutras, we have the five. It is the 10 hands of Durga, which is the 5 fingers of one arm and the 5 fingers of the other arm, which is called the 5 yamas and the 5 niyamas. What are these 10 hands of Durga symbolically representing in our life? The first is ahimsa, loving kindness and non-injury. Aspect of injuring people, injuring your loved ones, you are using one weapon of Durga. Then comes Satya. Satya is honesty and non-lying. Killing the dishonesty. When you're killed, when you're using this virtue to kill the lack of objectivity, lack of untruth, lack of correct expression, the way you should express, you are killing those. You are using another arm of Durga. The third yama, which is the third arm of Durga, is generosity and non-stealing. Generosity means not only donating by money, generously loving, generously sharing, generously giving whatever, giving your time is also generosity. And stealing, for example, you may say, I don't steal. But if, for example, if you see a married man having a relation with another woman, he is also stealing. He is stealing the love which is due to his wife and giving it away to another woman. So he is stealing love. So suppose the wife dies after 20 years, 30 years, and he grows old. He has brought up his children in a very, very beautiful way, giving all his life and his dedication. And when his children have grown up and he has, the children are settled in US and they don't even call him. They don't even find out. Maybe once in a year, once in 6 months they call. He wonders that what happened? I have given so much of love, care, so much of all my entire life I have dedicated, but they do not love me. They do not take care of me. What is basically happening? He has actually this evil within him. As long as that evil is there within him, the stealing is there, the stealing energy is there within him, what will happen is he will attract or he will distract love. He will distract honesty. He will not get people generously taking care of him. So these are related to every arm of Durga, which symbolically represents these. Fourth comes Brahmacharya. Brahmacharya means focus, constancy of aim and effort at one point. A child at the age of 5, he is probably a farmer's son. Maybe the farmer is uneducated. He has never gone to school. But when this child sees the aeroplane and he thinks that one day I wish I sit on that and drive that aeroplane, that once it will attract positive energies from the universe, and finally it will make him fulfill his dream. So he is eliminating by himself all the obstacles. So a brahmachari, what he does, he is focused. He is one-pointed. Anything distracting him, he will remove those. Even in Hindu mythology, if you have read that Narada used to come with these dancers, these apsaras, to distract these saints who used to meditate. So what was required that time was this particular weapon or this shakti. These are all different shaktis given by God. So this shakti of brahmacharya, one-pointedness, which will make the person fulfill his dream and desire. And in this one arm, the last one is aparigraha, which means moderation and non-excessiveness. So when there is balance, you are not excessive, you are not addicted to anything, whether it is drinking, whether it is watching TV, whether it is mobile, whatever it is, you have balance in life, everything in balance, then you will have balance in every part of your life. So balance in your nature, when you are destroying the excessiveness, when you are destroying the lack of brahmacharya within you, when you're destroying the stealing aspect within you or lack of generosity within you, when you are destroying the, lying, dishonesty within you, when you are destroying the tendency to injure people verbally, mentally or emotionally, you are using the five arms of Durga. Similarly, as per the niyamas, the Patanjali Yoga Sutras have actually explained the other five arms, the other five shaktis that God given us. So the first comes purification. And basically the festival of Durga, the Durga Puja and the Navaratri is basically the celebration of purification. I'm going to come to that in details. So the next comes contentment or meditation. When you meditate, what happens? All your stresses, your tensions, you're killing those. The tensions, the worries, the stresses. So when you meditate, when you concentrate, when you focus, when you go within your home, when you go within yourself, what happens is you get santosha or you get contentment. Next comes tapasa. Tapasa means serving and donating. Tithing means donation. When you are donating, when you are serving, that is a shakti that God has given us. So when you are serving people, you get shakti. When you are generously sharing, giving, you are donating, you are actually being, you are mastering tapasa. Next comes Svadhyaya, which means self-study. Study here means gathering more and more knowledge. Why do we go to school, college? Why do we come to this world? We come to this world because Mother Earth is nothing but the school for every one of us. With every experience we are learning, with every challenge we are learning something new. We are gathering our wisdom. We are gathering experience. We are gathering knowledge. So it is self-study happening. So the more we are, exposed to challenges like Ma Durga, when she was exposed, she has used her 10 arms. So she has also acquired more knowledge, more wisdom, more power. So that is what self-study or Swadhyaya means in one of the arms. The last arm is Ishvara Pranidhana, which means devotion to God and Sharanagati. So here comes the most important aspect of Durga. She is made out of all the aspects of God, the aspects of Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. When all those three aspects have made her together, combining their energies, she is a bundle of God. So she has lot of devotion. She has lot of Sharanagati. One of her arms are representing, Sharanagati means devotion towards your guru or towards your God. Giving you example, Hanumana. Hanuman is basically the devotion aspect of God. That is, he wants to clone himself like Rama. Why? Because he wants to be just like Rama. And when he has that Sharanagati, that devotion, that is the time when Rama gives him the power to move mountains. So this is a very, very important Shakti that God has given us in one of the arms of Durga. When you have devotion and Sharanagati, you can also move mountains. You can achieve the impossible. So these are the representation of the 10 arms of Durga. Now Durga comes, we know in the in Bengal, we see that Durga comes in different transportations. Durga comes to her mother's place with her children to spend 4-5 days with her mother. So when she comes home to her mother, she's completely relaxed. Her children are there playing, having fun. She comes, she's completely relaxed. And those 5 days, when she's over with it, on the 10th day, she kills all the demons, she kills Asura on the 10th day, and then finally she goes back. Now, if you think about yourself, you as the Durga aspect of God in you, when you, during these 5 days of Durga Puja or during these 9-10 days of Navratri, when you go into your own home, means what? You go into your inner self. Within your inner self, there is peace. There is calm. There is absolutely tranquility. There is bliss. When you go there is no stress. It is your own comfort zone. And what does children represent? Children is the creation of Durga. Who are the children of the Durga within us? All the vices and virtues which we have created. For example, if I have intolerance, that is one child I've given birth to. If I have love, I have given birth to another child. If I have intolerance, I've given birth to another child. These are our children. So go inward, inside, introspect these few days. See what are the demons and what are your true children. Preserve the virtues, the good children within you, and demolish all the evil children that you have given birth. Those are your own products. So you see in Durga Puja, what happens basically, everybody wears new clothes. Even in Navratri, you wear new clothes, you do shopping. There's so much of excitement. There's so much of, you know, fun. It prepares, people prepare for 1 month, 2 months. Now, what is basically happening? Before you are completely purified, I said the 10 arms, one was purification. That is what happens in Durga Puja. You need to purify your inner self. To purify your inner self, you are actually creating new clothes. What are the new clothes? You are unwearing your old clothes. You are unwearing all your old self. And you're creating your new self. The creation of the new self with only good virtues, with only positivity, with only purity, with only innocence, with only divinity, with only spirituality. Spirituality means divinity. Divinity means purity. When you are creating that, when you are demolishing all the asuras within you, you are wearing your new clothes for the next 1 year. Right? So we have the Shashti, the sixth day, that is what is celebrated in Bengal. Then the seventh day, then the eighth day, Ashtami, Navami, and then finally the Dashami. These are the 5 days when she comes to mother's home. That is, you go into your own home, you celebrate. The celebration is creating the new you, restoring and preserving the new you that is there. So you are using the Durga, the Shakti essence or the Shakti aspect of your, the God's essence, which is there within you. You are using the Shakti within you. You are using the Shiva aspect and the Parvati aspect to create a new you within yourself. So this, I will just show for a minute. This is, you will have. Vandana and the Aarti are different.
Ring Sri Esha Patandana Patra Pushpandari Sri Chandaye Harini Trailokya.
So basically what is happening, it is basically purification. The mantras, when they are chanting, what does the mantras do? The mantras are purifying the whole place. It is purifying the person. It is purifying everything around you. So that Shakti is to be used to purify yourself. So there is also this Dhunuchi dance, you know, which happens. They dance with this mud pot and there is camphor in it. And it emits a lot of fumes and there is a dance that happens with it. So what is happening symbolically, I can't go into everything, but what is happening, this is actually also used for purification. The fumes actually purify the energy of the whole place, bringing down the divine energy and giving power to the whole celebration. Then comes the last day when it is the Vijaya, Shubha Vijaya. So what happens, you know, the Bengali ladies, they will wear the say sindoor khel. They play with sindoor. They put sindoor on mother, you know, on Parvati's forehead, on the, you know, on the forehead. And then they also use it for each other. What does it imply? Let me tell you. How did sindoor come into existence? Earlier, when tribes used to be there, that time, if the head of the tribe would like any woman, he would want to own him so that no other man would look at him. So he would cut the forehead of that woman with his knife. It would bleed and that mark would remain. The blood mark would remain. And that gradually became the red sindoor. So the moment a man marries, he basically makes the woman wear sindoor, meaning you belong to me. So when a person, as long as a woman does not wear sindoor, it is a representation that I am available. I do not belong to anybody, permanently. I mean, permanently in the sense, in this lifetime. So the sindoor, this also has the significance of belongingness. That means Durga belongs to Shiva. Shiva belongs to Durga, meaning the Shakti belongs to the destroyer of evil God, who is Shiva. They work hand in hand, complementary to each other. So when they are, you know, complementary, working together, hand in hand, then what happens? You can achieve ultimate success. So basically, that is why this, you know, this is a representation of the Shakti with the Shiva together. So at the end, on the 10th day, she is fighting, she is killing Asura with her own Shakti combined with the Shakti of Shiva. Both the male and female energies, both the male aspect, female aspect of God, both these together is the ultimate power with which you can kill everything. So within us, if you go within yourself, what is the Shiva energy? The Shiva energy is nothing but the willpower that you have. You have identified, you have these vices, you have these weaknesses. Then you use the Shakti, the power to destroy it with your willpower given by the god Shiva. With that willpower, when you kill them, the finally the asura within you is killed. Okay, this I'll show you a little of how it happens. All. Then the last day comes when we do the immersion. So the immersion happens usually in river Ganges or in small ponds and all. The immersion basically symbolizes sacrificing all those vices, all those negativities from your life. Permanently, when you sacrifice those and you eliminate those, you throw them out, you release them, you throw them out of your life. If there is somebody, you know, spoiling your life or taking advantage of your life, you throw that person out. You are using your Shiva and Shakti aspect of you. You are using your Durga and your Shiva power within you. 10th day, basically what is happening is you are sacrificing all the negativities of your life. That is what the immersion represents or symbolizes. Then we come to Navratri. So Navratri, we know it happens through the 9 days. Every day there is a new incarnation of Parvati. For example, so there are the 9 different aspects, different, you know, these are actually, as I said, that I, Mondrita, is playing different roles. This is same Shakti playing different roles in different forms. So Durga is coming in different names with different roles to play in the Navratri. So in Navratri, you see, you keep Vrat. In your physical body, when you are doing Vrat, your every organ of your body is getting rest. They are not tensed. They are not stressed that I have to function every day. You are giving rest to them. So what is happening? They are getting purified. And then every day with the new incarnation of the new aspect of Parvati, you are basically taking hold, taking control over the virtues, the strengths of your inner aspects, the strengths of your life. With every day, with every incarnation of different aspects of Durga, you are basically taking control over your positive aspects. You are enhancing your strengths. You are enhancing your virtues. So this I have already told you. I don't need to go through this. So then comes the Dashera. What is happening in the Dashera? The Dashera, basically all those you have identified, the weaknesses you have identified, the negative challenges you have identified, the negative aspects you have identified, the vices you have identified, you are killing them all on the Dashera day. So finally, you are sacrificing those. You're chopping off the heads of each and every vice within you. When you are doing that, you see, Rama had done it. So here also is the same. As I said in Dashami, we are having the Sindur festival. So there the Shiva aspect comes. Here what is happening is Rama aspect comes. Rama is also Vishnu. So what is he doing? He's preserving the goodness. So what the Vishnu aspect within you, the Rama within you on the Dashera, has to restore, has to preserve, basically, has to preserve the goodness that you have, but sacrifice, eliminate, retrench all the negative aspects. Even if there are challenges in your life, when you are finding the solutions to it, you are using in your willpower, you are using your creatively your thinking with your ideas. That is, you are using your Brahma aspect to think of new ideas, how to solve that problem. When you get the solution, what has happened is your Shiva has actually taken over. The willpower is there. Parvati aspect is there. It is taking over the solution, eliminating the problem. You are then, just getting over that. So you're preserving then the solution. You're providing that solution. You're preserving that solution. And then finally, you are using that solution to make your life better. So these are a few things that, Ma Parvati has to say to you on Navratri. So bless you on these auspicious, Navratras. Happy Durga Puja to all of you. I will now come to the question answer session. I hope now you can put on your videos. These are just my numbers and my, email ID. In case you have any questions, if you have any kind of queries, you can email to me. You can also call me. I'm a call away. I do conduct sessions regularly online also. I'm doing complimentary sessions every day to, I started when the pandemic started. Then I started these sessions to ward off, for my tourism friends, to ward off fear of pandemic. And, the participants have enjoyed it so much. Some of the participants, I hope they are here. They may also give a response that they have continued. So, when you relate all these to your own life, then you will have a Durga Puja every day in your own life. Every day you can celebrate Durga Puja. Every day you can celebrate Navratri in your life, in your home, within your family. So I thank you very much, all of you. You can take a picture if you want of the numbers. Thank you very much, all of you. Now you can switch on your videos. I will stop sharing. You can switch on your videos and whatever questions you have, you can ask me. I'm open for that. And also please give a feedback, whatever you feel about the session.
Yeah. Namaste again. Thank you, Mandrita, for this excellent session. In fact, we just didn't know how the 1 hour passed by, and mainly I would like to acknowledge the spiritual side of the festival that you brought in. While everybody understands the religious side, but then the idea of the wisdom behind these festivals, that kind of give us was something brought out extremely well. And as I see from the chat side, it's been an amazing feedback from people. I don't see any much questions, but in case if any questions, you can just raise your hand and put it. And Arul, you can allow the mics to be unmuted in case somebody wants to have a question.
Okay.
You may also put on your videos if you don't mind. I can see everybody, you are alive, you are there.
Yeah, you can put your videos and raise your hand and we will unmute so that you can speak and ask the question. Or you can put it on the chat for her to look up. In fact, we have another few more days of celebrations. I was in Gujarat on the 17th, the first day of Navratri. Of course, the fanfare of the Garba was missing. But then, the spirit is there. So everybody is kind of celebrating in home and across. So you have been living in Bombay. Tell us something about Durga Puja in Bombay, in Mumbai.
Yeah, sir, there are 700. In Mumbai, right. What I have experienced and noticed is, that they follow in every puja in, of course, there are some filmy style pujas that happen also in Mumbai, but rituals that happen, those rituals are absolutely perfectly done because every ritual has a significance why it is happening. For example, I'll just give you one example that, you know, when suppose they put a red bindi on Mother Durga, it activates the wisdom aspect. Eye is activated. So the mother can see the inner, you know, whatever is happening, the inner wisdom. Similarly, when the diya, when they take the big, you know, pradipa, and then the lamp, when they are rotating, for example, during the aarti, three times they do it left hand side, three times they do it right hand side. So three times when they're doing it left hand side, what really happens is it removes all negative aspects. And when it is turned into the right hand side, it is energizing with divine energy. It brings down, attracts divine energy and pours down into the whole environment. So the first three times it is neutralizing all the negative energies from the entire environment. Second time it is doing, you know, the right hand side is doing. So this way, each and every ritual that happens has a significance. Every 4 kilometers, 5 kilometers, you will find there are Durga Pujas. And yes, people also go at night with buses and travel from one to the other.
Yeah, there's a question from Naina. She's asking, can you explain more about Saraswati? According to my knowledge, she is
Saraswati is
Brahma.
Yeah. Right. Saraswati is basically the aspect of God. I'm talking in relevance to Durga or Durga Puja. So she is the knowledge aspect of God, where Brahma is creation. Just like you create, you need the wisdom, the knowledge. So she provides the knowledge of everything, whether it is, for example, in our human life, if you see a singer, any artist who is a singer, a kalakar, they worship Saraswati. Why? Because those skills, those talents, those knowledge, all those are given by Saraswati, which is that aspect of God. So that is what...
Modi ji, this is Sanjay Vora, yes, from Delhi. Well, I am RLG in Delhi, yes, and you've been knowing. I had the good fortune of attending your. The best thing I like that people simply think is in India, majority that by doing fasting or just doing dhoop bhatti to goddess every day we are praying. You know, the best thing I like, which I've circulated in my group also, I send it to you, that these 10 days are like observing and self-evaluation. Of removing our defilements. You know, the best thing which touched me, we all, you know, like people merely think that by doing these rituals, these dogmas, you know, we can get rid of our sins. But as you said, killing your evils within you, you know, that is the best thing. And the way you have elaborated, very subtle, you know, you have given us, it's an eye-opener. I think we all were, I got overwhelmed when you were, I have noted, And we are really fortunate, the people who are attending, that, you know, Goddess Durga is giving you power to bestow this great wisdom and knowledge. And the way you have blended the other, you know, like in religion, like all world, like it's Vasudev Katukumba, the whole world is ours. I mean, the way even in Islam or Judaism, or Christianity, the way you have blended. I mean, it's an eye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mandi.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yes, Anjali, your question. You have to be a little louder, please. Yes.
Okay. We worship Shanta Durga as our Kuladev.
Mm-hmm.
She is at Goa. But tell me, why do we call her Shanta Durga?
Okay. Every incarnation of goddess or any god has different roles to play. For example, when Vishnu was born as Krishna, Krishna is basically the love aspect of God. Similarly, when he was born as Ram, he had a different role to play. So similarly, Durga's 9 incarnations have different roles. when she is taking birth and so Shanta Durga is basically she's preserving, she is a preserver at that point of time. She preserves the good. That is what Shanta Durga is basically meant for.
Thank you.
Okay, welcome. Anybody else, any other question?
Fine, I think
okay. It's been a great session. You very much. Yeah. I hope all of you have enjoyed.
And again, let's continue with the spirit of festival, the Navratri, and bring in the goodness. And as you said, try to identify the evil within us and see we finish it off as much as possible with our own inner powers. And thank you, Manorita, for taking time.
Thank you.
And accepting our invitation to speak. And that was a great effort. You have done a lot of research. And I think the feedback says it all, how good it has been. We look forward to having you sometime in future. Once again, thank you all. And thanks to Parul,
who has
been behind and supporting us with all the technical support and knowledge so that the webinar goes smoothly. Thank you, Parul, from Safari Plus for supporting us. Also, thank our team here in India.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. I thank you, sir. I thank the entire tourism department and, of course, Parul for being at the back end supporting. I'm very grateful for this opportunity. I hope we all become channels of spreading light in this Navratri and in this Durga Puja. Thank you. Wish you all the best.
सिंहस्थ शशि शेखरा मरकत प्रेक्षा चतुर्भुज शंख चक्र धनु शरांश दधति नैत्रयी स्त्री शोभिता
जागो